Andy was a man, so that wasn't very good marketing on her behalf to try to sell this to him. And he kept rejecting her. She would come to the factory and he would say, "Valerie, I'm not interested, please leave." Well, she unfortunately thought that Andy Warhol was controlling her life. And one day she walked into the factory with a gun and she shot Andy at point blank range and two other people that were there at the factory. The bullets hit every major organ except Andy's heart. He was clinically dead for several moments until the paramedics arrived and revived him. And he spent 6 months in the hospital recovering from that incident. And I think that's when he realized that he was so famous that people were out to assassinate him just as they assassinated President Kennedy. And in true Andy fashion, as soon as he came to from all of the drugs and the operations, he said to one of his staff, "How's my press?" And the staff person had to say, "I don't know how to tell you this, but Bobby Kennedy was assassinated the next day. And your headlines were wiped off the face of the paper." And he was really upset about that. Very typical of Andy. But again, just that idea that he now is a commodity and people want a piece of him just as they want to see his art and to consume it as well. This is a flower painting from 1964. This is the only time that Andy Warhol was ever sued for using somebody else's image. He always used somebody else's image, whether it's the Marilyn photo, the Elvis photo, the Campbell soup cans. They actually wrote him a cease and desist letter. "Please refrain from using our branding in your painting," until they realized that it was more free advertising than they could ever hope for, and then they actually started to support him. Well, this image that was taken from a very standard photograph of a yard, it was in Life magazine, and he saw these four flowers in that picture, cut it out of the rest of the photo, had the silk screen made, blew it up to large scale. Well, unfortunately for him, the photographer who took that picture came to the opening of the flower paintings, and she realized that those were her flowers. And she took her magazine and the photograph to the gallery and compared and realized, yes, that's mine, and she sued him. He settled out of court, made tens of thousands of dollars and several of the paintings. But the only time in his lifetime that Warhol was sued for appropriating someone else's image for something as mundane as a flower. In addition to the painting and the films and the works on paper that Andy was producing, he also realized that he should become a publisher. So he started Interview Magazine in 1969, which continues to this day. And the reason he said he did so was, well, A, he loved movies, B, he loved to save money. He realized if he had a film magazine, that he would be invited to all of the Hollywood movie premieres for free, and get to go to the premiere and meet all the celebrities. And it worked perfectly. As soon as Andy Warhol's interviews started to come out, everybody clamored to be on the cover, whether it was Liza Minnelli, his good friend, through to all of the great celebrities of his age. And this was yet another way for him to produce, to get his message across. One of the last things that I'll talk about, because I'll be wrapping up in a few minutes, so I stay on the hour, is the commissioned portraits that Andy started doing in earnest in the 1970s. He'd done a few in the 1960s. He painted Edward Stahl, who was a great art collector. He painted Bobby Short, who was the famous lounge singer at the Carlisle Hotel in New York. And he did those using photo booth pictures. So you take the client down to a photo booth, down the block, have them sit in one of those old style photo machines, click the photograph, and then you can have the screen prints made from those, and then the paintings. Well, as we get into the 70s, Andy started to use Polaroids. When Polaroid, the company, came out with their first camera, they gave one to Andy and said, "Experiment with this, see what you can do." And he loved it. It was instantaneous, you could see it right away, and he just had that camera with him. He had a camera and a tape recorder with him almost everywhere he went. It's interesting, Andy tape recorded every single phone conversation he had throughout his entire life. When the phone rang, he hit record, and the entire thing would be recorded. We have thousands of tapes of all of his phone conversations. The foundation has actually put a ban on them for public display or public broadcast for 50 years. because Andy loved to gossip. And he said a lot of really nasty things about a lot of important people. And, you know, I'm sure some of you have read the Andy Warhol diaries, which are from those tapes. Well, the foundation was getting sued left and right when the diaries came out. So whether it was Jerry Hall suing because he said she had B.O., Bianca Jagger suing over this, that, or the other thing, they finally just said, listen, we can't put ourselves at risk anymore. So the tapes were sealed for 50 years. So we had another 36 years to go before we can ever play those tapes at the museum. But at any rate, Andy started to use Polaroid to take pictures of clients. And by this time, Andy had gone from hanging out with the underground artists and the underground musicians in New York in the 60s. By the 70s, he was a true and established member of the international jet set. He was traveling all over the world, he was on private jets, he was on Concorde, going to London, to Paris, going to Aspen, Colorado. He actually bought a piece of land out in Colorado. And I was just talking to one of his close friends the other day, who was standing there with him when he bought it. And he said, Andy, what are you going to do? Are you going to build a great house or a mansion? Or what are you going to do with this land? And he said, oh, no, I love it just the way it is. It's nature. It's perfect. I'm not doing anything. And his friend said, oh, well, and he never did. He never built anything on that property. So he spent a lot of his money for a nice view, basically. But at any rate, with these Polaroid-based commissioned portraits, he started to realize that all of his friends were really, really rich, and they all wanted an Andy Warhol painting. And it's very easy to believe you'd have the sitter come into the factory or in their home, shoot maybe 4 dozen to 8 dozen Polaroids, and then he would pick the best image. He would often use white pancake makeup on the women to get rid of any flaws that they might have, any wrinkles, any blemishes. So very kabuki, very geisha, and it got rid of everything. And sometimes, you can see here, Carolina Herrera has a fair amount of white makeup on. But even before he would send the finished Polaroid shows to the screen printer,